Welcome to the Great Shrimp Shoal. Today we're going to be revisiting the 30 and the 10 gallon tanks, and we'll be seeing some stuff that we haven't covered before, including how I remineralized the water after a cleaning, and how the bamboo shrimp had been feeding recently. It's very interesting to watch, and I have some time-lapse video. So let's get things started. Welcome to the show. The mountains are humming along quite nicely, and each cast of shrimp has their own feeding habits. Now that the tank has been cleaned, it's intriguing to see how each shrimp chooses to forage and find their food. They are each their own characters, and the individual species have their own quirks too. This is not the first time that I've caught the bamboo shrimp attached directly to the return outlet from the canister filter. But it is the closest that he's crammed himself in there. It makes me wonder if it isn't time to clean the pipes or other components, as this probably means that the water flow has slowed down quite a bit. I'm using a new canister sponge that has much more fine pores, so that may be the source of all this slowing down. I guess I'm trading cleaner water for reduced flow. Perhaps there is a balance somewhere in between. I'll have to experiment a little bit. I have been trying to catch a molting, but try as I might, I only get to see the leftover shells when I wake up in the morning. I have been experimenting with time-lapse videos as well, but there's only so much time in the day. I am not currently at a place where I can film these majestic shrimp 24/7, and the light turns off at night, so that complicates filming just a little bit. Here we have the snowball shrimp getting started on a newly added food pellet. I am currently weaning them off of this type of food to try and integrate a different type soon, but the introduction process has not been started. I don't have the heart to take the food away from them in increasing amounts, and I am unsure whether or not they will appreciate and eat the new food, so I'll have to guide it along a little bit. This big one here is the largest of my snowball shrimp, and she is easily 1.5 times the size of her nearest neighbor. Now that doesn't mean that she has the rule of the roost, because sometimes I've seen the smaller shrimp edge her out of a meal. And usually the small intruder is enough to scare even the biggest of the invertebrates. You would think with all that armor they'd be a little bit more stalwart, but I guess evolution means that it pays to be on your toes when things are looking to eat you. I haven't seen this matriarch feeding on the pine cones though, and she doesn't seem to be interested in the same type of food or biofilm that attracts the smaller shrimp. No, this gal likes to go after the decaying leaves instead first, or simply waits until I add the food pellet to the tank during the feeding sessions. This is a 1 or 2 hour time lapse of the bamboo shrimp waiting below the filter return and grabbing whatever bits are kicked up by the turbulence. I don't think that anything significant is coming out of the return, but they could also be eating the stuff that grows in the tubes before it blooms to enter the tank. And this would be an ideal spot to catch all of that stuff as it floats down. This also shows you how determined to stay in one spot these beautiful shrimp are. They are a model of peak efficiency. And in order to maintain their size, they have to eat a lot but also move around very slowly to keep their energy expenditure to a minimum. It is a complex balance that these shrimp seem to do well with. They use their fans like straw brooms, and after they catch stuff, they scrape the particles that are caught into their mouths using their maxillipeds. You can also see here how they use their legs that have a very pointy end to prop themselves up and grab hold of difficult to grip surfaces. You can see there that the tip is a darker color, and it brings to mind lobsters and crabs who have a dark tip to most of their legs as well. All of the same body parts are here on the bamboo shrimp that other shrimp have, including the dwarf shrimp. Apart from the chelipeds and the fans, they use the same parts and techniques to conduct their daily routines. It's also interesting to note that they still poop a ton, even though the particles that they catch in their fan are so tiny. Again, that speaks to volume over time, which is something that these shrimp are very good at. Because these bamboo shrimp breed in a brine environment and then go through their larval stage, only returning to freshwater a few days after hatching, I can assume that their feeding habits involve the turbulent waters of a river delta, where the ocean meets the river water. And there, the nutrients probably look a lot different than in this freshwater tank. The juvenile snowball shrimp have grown up fast, and as I've said before, it's hard to spot their discarded carapace, so with that, it's difficult to get a good read on the number of smaller shrimp and how they're growing up. But they do like to perch on the rock surfaces and pluck biofilm from the crevices, at least more so than the larger adults. After doing a bit more research on the bamboo shrimp, I've learned that they are their happiest when they can sit in one place and feed all day by using the currents. But when you see them scrounging on the ground or grooming the plants like this one, that may be a sign that food is becoming harder to come by. It's all relative though. Sometimes I'm sure I've seen one bamboo shrimp raking in the food while the other is combing the substrate. I guess overall it wouldn't hurt to overfeed the filter feeders for the time being. For them, I let them forage off the algae growing in the tank and let them catch any food fragments that are floating around too. But when food is scarce and the filter is doing a really good job, I can use a bacterial additive like Glass Garden's Bacter AE. This promotes the formation of biofilm for baby shrimp, and it allows for free-floating bacteria and algae for the bamboo shrimp to feed off of. I haven't used the additive recently, but if it does help feed the bamboo shrimp and helps the baby shrimp survival rates, it may be worth adding more often, even if it does mean more frequently needing to clean the tank water. Overall, though, I'd say the bamboo shrimp are doing fine. I did lose one earlier on, but the remaining two have been feeding and do look to be in good health. They have almost the same life expectancy, maybe a little bit longer, than the Neocaridina shrimp. So that one that passed away may have been an error on my part, or it just may have been his time to go. That was also right when I was starting to figure out the water parameters, so he may have been having trouble getting out of his carapace in some of his first few moultings in the tank. Overall, there's about 15 to 20 snowball shrimp working their way around the tank at any one given time, and the females are pregnant more often, so I should be looking to see some more baby shrimp sometime very soon. When I designed this tank, I inadvertently gave the shrimp a lot of space to hide in, and that includes cracks in the rocks, the entirety of the back-facing rocks, and the largest rock that forms the mountains actually has a couple of holes that pass right through it, which the moss has been inserted into. So there could be baby shrimp hiding in there, and that would be an ideal environment for them to find biofilm and safety. Still, if I want to see more shrimp, I guess I'll have to do the same thing that I was planning on doing for the bamboo shrimp, and that means inserting some kind of bacterial aid into the water column to promote the growth of biofilm. Here's one of the baby snowball shrimps now. I'd have to say that this is after its second or third molting, and right now it's about the size of a long grain rice. This is just about the time the lights turn off on the timer, so perhaps this little shrimp is getting ready to venture out onto the substrate under the cover of darkness. I've spotted them all over the tank in various places, including the backside of the sponge filters, and the Higer sponge filter actually has ridges where baby shrimp could find a perfect hiding spot. I forget that those sponge filters are positively teeming with gunky biomatter before they're cleaned, and the rest of the filter structure is slimy when I pull them out during the cleaning, so to be honest, there should be enough for them to eat. I guess it all boils down to whether or not they can find it, especially if it's better in one spot in the tank versus another. You can also see that lone bamboo shrimp peeking his way into the frame in the back over there. Right now, there's a lot of stuff stuck to the filter intake because it needs to be cleaned, so it's probably attractive to all the different kinds of shrimp. It's really interesting to note two additional things. First, the copepods have all but disappeared. I see them every so often jumping in and out of the pores on the sponge filter, but I haven't seen them in the amount that I first observed in the forest. There was one point I swear I could see that there were thousands swarming all over the sponge filter. Copepods are great though, and they are a good indicator that food is abundant and that the tank is healthy. The other thing I noticed is that the rhabdocola are also showing smaller numbers. They're still there, but I mostly see them along the line of the substrate at the bottom of the tank instead of clumped up in various places on the side of the glass. To be perfectly honest, I only really notice what's at the edge of the tank, and for every worm I see on the glass, there's bound to be hundreds more enjoying their life happily in the middle of the tank that I never see. I had so much fun looking at the time lapses of the bamboo shrimp feeding that I decided to try one more for this week's video, this time with the snowballs getting their first chips on the food pellet when it was dropped into the tank. When that food pellet hits the floor, it doesn't take more than a minute for the largest snowball and the rest of the mid-sized shrimp before they are on it, tearing chunks off in an effort to get to the best parts. The pellet lasts a long time though. Typically an entire day before the only thing that's left are little shreds here and there around the tank. You can also see popping in here the two female snowballs who've developed different colors from the other snowball shrimp. There's one tan colored one and one that's a reddish pink. I really can't wait to see if they've made some of the baby shrimp. But I'll have to wait a long while to find out, because these female adult shrimp didn't show any of their alternate coloration until just recently. It is a really nice color though. Just look at it, it's like a peach or a tan cream color, somewhat like a coffee or a cake. It might be just a portion of their wild color poking through in these individuals. But perhaps it is a genetic trait from another color of Neocaridina that they were tanked with. Time will tell for certain. Here is one of them with eggs too, so it looks like another round of babies is due sometime soon. That's it for this week's episode. Thank you guys for showing up to watch some of the stuff going on between the two tanks. Anyway, I hope to see you guys next time, and we'll be covering the rehabilitation of that massive new tank that I have. And after that, we're going to get into stocking it pretty quickly. Of course, waiting for it to cycle first. Thank you guys once again, and I'll see you next time. Oh, and don't forget to have some sweet shrimpy dreams, because that's always important. Good night.